Talk about chapter 7, Attitudes and Persuasion. Kind of a fascinating chapter. Let's go ahead and get started, maybe. There we go. Okay, Attitudes and Persuasion, chapter 7. Attitudes are the evaluative tendency toward an object. The tendency to evaluate is automatic. We evaluate everything that we come across. It is the way that we stayed alive when we were living in a dangerous world. And there was very little protection for humans, so we needed to develop an attitude toward everything that we came across, whether it was a frog or a river or a tree or a plant. We needed to develop an attitude toward it to determine if it was safe or unsafe. Examples are self-esteem, the fact that we believe in ourselves, interpersonal attraction, who it is that we want to be near, our prejudices, the fact that I don't like, I don't eat raw tomatoes very often. Sometimes I do, I guess. What else am I prejudiced against? I can't think of anything. I don't drink alcoholic beverages. I'm prejudiced against alcoholic beverages. Marijuana. I don't use marijuana, and I never have. And of course, friendships. I like to befriend everybody that I'm around. Implicit attitudes are activated automatically from our memory. These tend to be outside conscious awareness. They're simple. They're gut level evaluations. What was I watching on television last night? Television show about three teenage kids that solve a mystery, and I was really feeling kindly toward those three kids. I like people that are nice to other people, so that was a gut level evaluation. Explicit attitudes are consciously held. They're careful and they're deliberate. This would be politics, for example. These you have to think about this person or that person as to whether you like their politics or not. You could be a Democrat or Republican. It really doesn't make any difference. The guy that's the next guy that is trying to get you to vote for them, you have to make a gut, a conscious deliberation as to whether you're going to accept him as your candidate or not. Implicit and explicit attitudes may contradict each other. And this is, what did they just do? Something just happened today. Oh, they just overturned Roe v. Wade. So, you know, it's a lot. You may be a Republican that believes that abortion should be legal. You may be a Democrat who doesn't believe that abortion should be legal. Sometimes they contradict one another. One way to measure implicit attitudes is with the implicit association test. The implicit association test pairs categories of items with positive and negative stimuli. For example, you press a key if the stimulus is good or refers to women. This gets really strange because I've taken this IAT and it showed that I was prejudiced against American Indians, which is kind of odd since I work, I've 15, 17 years of my life I have spent teaching American Indians. It's a little odd that I would have a prejudice against them. Against individuals that, I traveled all the way up to Montana to work on the reservation. And I traveled all the way to Arizona to work on the reservation, while my home is actually in Iowa. Little odd. Anyway, so what you do is they show you a picture of a woman and you have to hit the positive button. So every time something good comes up, you hit that button. It's the time that you delay in hitting the button. How long do you have to think about it before you can hit the good button or the bad button? You press a different key if the stimulus is bad or refers to men. This is just an example. They will reverse it. Men are good and women are bad in the next one. How long does it take you to answer the question? And of course, they do it with different races. They do it with African Americans. They do it with Hispanics. They do it with they do it with American Indians as well, if I remember correctly. Then they reverse the pairings, of course. The IAT assesses reaction time to see if the individual is faster at pairing good things with one category or the other. So if I were a misogynist and I liked men, but I wasn't real crazy about women, then it would I would delay between I would have a longer delay if I had to say that a woman was good than if I had to say a man was good. That's the idea. I'm not exactly sure how well this works. Like I said, I've taken it and it didn't make a lot of sense to me. I was thinking, does this really have to do with my implicit attitudes? Reference group is a group in which we orient ourselves, a group with which we emotionally identify, a group whose standards we use to judge ourselves and others. Newcomb's Bennington College study showed that the effects of reference groups are profound. So what happened? Well, Bennington College is up in Vermont. Wait a minute, why do I have these pictures up here? Oh, this is a reference group, and these are influencers. That's why I have these pictures up here. Here's The Rock. I don't recognize all these people. As a matter of fact, that's Kim Kardashian, I think. And that's The Rock. This is Ronaldo, who plays for Real Madrid. The rest of these people I really don't recognize. This is a guy. I can't think of his name. Okay, well, anyway, those are all influencers from the internet. You guys probably know them, but I have no clue who most of them are, except the older ones. Anyway, we're talking about a reference group. Okay, so the Bennington College study was done in the 1930s, in the middle 1930s. This is Bennington College. Bennington College is a highbrow college for women in Vermont. And this is what it looks like. This is what it looked like in the 1930s. There's a graduation. Here's all the girls that are graduating. I'm sorry, young women that are graduating. The Bennington College experiment took place between 1935 and 1939. Theodore Newcomb decided to measure attitude changes of the women's freshman class over the course of a college career. The all-female student body at Bennington College tended toward affluent conservative families of New England. The faculty at the time were all male, fairly liberal individuals in their 30s. So the idea is all these girls came in fairly conservative because they came from conservative families from New England, and the faculty was primarily male and fairly liberal. And of course, they were all young men. Wait a minute, there's one. So he was in his 30s. This is a class. This is the way they have their classrooms. You can, and if you go to Ivy League schools, a lot of times they will have these seminar classes where you just kind of sit around in comfortable chairs. She's sitting on the floor for some reason, even though there's places to sit. Okay. Newcomb discovered that with education, most of the conservative adolescents became liberal young adults by graduation. Not all the students became liberal, but the ones that changed were more likely to seek independence from their families. They were more socially secure. They had a higher self-esteem and were less socially isolated. Now, strangely enough, I went to college in the 1960s, graduated from Wabash in 1971, started in 1967. And when I came in, I was relatively conservative as well. But by the time I left, I was fairly liberal. So the same thing had happened to me. I had gone to college. I learned new things. I was around other people. And I realized that the conservative way of looking at things was not totally accurate. The liberal attitudes became very stable. Follow-up studies of the 1939 graduates in the 1960s and 1990s found that women maintained their liberal orientation was 0.47, which is pretty high if you think about it. And these are women from the study. As you can see, they are wearing clothes that were a little risque for the time. Those are sundresses. But they are above their knees, and that's what they're actually showing off. They're showing off their legs. And this is Martha Graham. Martha Graham was a choreographer, and she was a choreographer for decades on Broadway, and she agreed to come up to Bennington. Actually, this is one of the first jobs she had, was teaching dance at Bennington College. And, of course, she was fairly avant-garde for the time. Seeing an unfamiliar stimulus many times can lead to liking. Unless the individual has initial negative reactions to it, then they will probably like it. Robert Zients identified the effect in 1968. The liking requires no knowledge of the object. Attitudes formed through mere exposure are often implicit. Neurological different brain areas account for different kinds of mere exposure effects. A possible explanation for the phenomenon is familiar objects are unlikely to be dangerous. And of course, if you have ever heard a song, the first time you heard it, you went, okay. And the next time you heard it, you went, wait a minute, I've heard this song before. And then after that, you kind of wait for this song to come on. I have developed favorite songs from just one part of the song. It's not the whole thing that I like. It's just one different part. And usually the more exposure you have to it, the more you like it. This is the way radio used to work back in the old days, back before you guys were all born. You couldn't really select the music that you listened to. You had to buy a record. And if you bought a record, of course, it's got, you know, 10 songs on one side and 10 songs on the other side. Or you could buy a 45, I guess. That's the only way you could listen to music. So if you're driving down the road, you can't really play your record player in the car. So you had to listen to the radio. And of course, you listened to AM or FM radio. It didn't really make any difference. But you listened to whatever was on the radio. And so there were a lot of disc jockeys that would play different songs, and you were waiting for your favorite song to come on. But you got to listen to all these other songs. So because that was the listening technique of everybody, we got to know all the songs, even the songs that we didn't like, because we had to listen to whatever was on the radio at the time. And that's the way it worked until we developed tape players. The first tape players were 8 tracks, and of course 8 tracks were fairly large and not that easy to use. It was hard to and they stretched the tape stretched, so the music started sounding kind of funny after a while. Same thing happened with cassettes, of course. It was very difficult to listen to the song that you wanted to hear. You had to wait until it came on. Attitudes can form through classical conditioning. A neutral stimulus paired with an object that naturally evokes an attitude response can cause a neutral object to come to evoke the same attitude response. Early research on prejudice showed that emotional components of prejudice could be classically conditioned. Classical conditioning of attitudes can occur below the level of conscious awareness, a process known as subliminal conditioning. When a behavior is rewarded, it is more likely to occur in the future. Receiving praise for holding an attitude is likely to strengthen the attitude. Attitudes can be shaped by observational learning. Individuals can learn an attitude by watching the way others are rewarded or punished as they interact with an attitude object. My grandson plays on a soccer team, and some of the players on the team aren't as good as others. But throughout the season, my daughter and I know a lot about soccer. So one of the things that we were doing was we were praising the kids when they did something that worked or did something well. And we weren't yelling at them when they did anything wrong. We weren't the coaches. We were just on the sideline. And by yelling positive things when they did something right, what we discovered was, and this wasn't really a discovery, we both coached fairly extensively through the years, but what happened was that because we were telling them when they did something well, they repeated that behavior. So by the end of the season, these kids who were not playing all that hot at the beginning of the season, they were all playing fairly well because they had learned from the from being rewarded with praise that this was what they were supposed to be doing. And when they did that, then somebody from the sideline would praise them. And of course, that's what we tried to get the other parents to do. Not always that successful. A lot of people don't believe in positive coaching. They would rather participate in negative coaching, mainly because the idea is that people need to be told what they're doing wrong, not what they're doing right. You know, since we weren't really the coaches, we were trying to be as positive as we possibly could. We didn't really care what the coaches were doing. Anyway, the team did much, much better. They won a tournament right at the end of the season. And the first tournament they played in, they got wiped out. I don't think they even scored a goal. But by the end of the season, and they beat the team that beat them like 7-0 at the beginning of the season. They beat the team 3-2. They beat them 3-2, they had ringers from the select team. They had moved some kids down to play on this in this tournament, and they beat them anyway. Attitudes are influenced by changes in facial expression, head movement, and body posture. One explanation is the facial feedback hypothesis. People infer their own emotional states from muscle position. Another explanation is the vascular theory of emotion. Some facial expressions cause cooling of blood to the brain, thus elevating mood. Arranging facial muscles to mimic a smile elevates mood, while frowning expression depresses mood. Body posture and motion can also affect attitudes. People are unaware of being affected by motor responses. Most likely explanation is classical conditioning. This is the experiment that they did. What they did, they gave somebody a pen and they had to hold it in their mouth. And they either held it in their mouth with their teeth or they held it in their mouth with their lips. Now, and then they showed them a funny movie. The people that were forced to smile, the ones that held the pen in their teeth rather than in their lips, those individuals found the movie funnier than the people who were kind of in a frown with their holding the pen in their lips. As interesting as that is, and I've never noticed. She's got this thing. I'm just wondering what it says. I can't read it. MEQUON. 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 I can't see it. I don't see it, but it's okay. Anyway, that's the original research that was done. Made probably not with this lady, but you can repeat it. I did it. I repeated it at when I was at Ashford, and I showed them Rugrats, a television show, Rugrats. And a cartoon, and had them from time to time. I had them write down how they were feeling about the cartoon, and the ones with the lips didn't like the cartoon nearly as much as the people that were holding it in their teeth. Persuasion is the process by which a message induces a change in beliefs, attitudes, or behavior. Researchers from the 1980s and 1990s. Determined that there are two routes to persuasion, the central route and the peripheral route. The central route involves focusing on the arguments. When the arguments are strong and compelling, persuasion is likely. When people hear an argument that is weak, they counter-argue and persuasion cannot take place. Advertisers rarely have a product that is so much better and different from all other similar products to use the central route of persuasion. Thus, most advertisers must use the peripheral route to persuasion, focusing on cues that trigger acceptance without much thinking. When people are distracted or not motivated to think, Easily understood familiar statements are more persuasive than novel statements with the same meaning. Ads for products often use visual peripheral cues. They associate their product to beauty, youth, and pleasure. And this is a technique that you see on television constantly, almost all the advertisements. Nobody's product is so much better than everybody else's. Ford, Chevy, Honda, Toyota, it really doesn't matter. The cars are all primarily the same. They even look the same. So how in the world are they going to get you to buy their cars, or to buy their beer, or to buy their detergent? They use pretty people, and they use fun stuff. They want to show you pretty people using their stuff. If you use it, then you will be thought of as younger, and it will give you pleasure. Now, this may be true of just about anything that you buy. I don't know if you're really trying to look younger, but they're using the subliminal route, the peripheral route. So it really doesn't matter whether it makes you actually feel that way or not. But the advertisement should make you buy their car. What was it? Mazda used to have a car advertisement where they would say zoom zoom, zoom zoom. That was what they said. So if you drove a Mazda, it made you feel like going faster. And of course, who goes faster? Pretty people, pretty young people, and it gives you a lot of pleasure going zoom zoom. Anyway, I have two Mazdas, so I zoom zoom all the time, especially in my Miata. Okay, advertisements. So we're talking about youth, pleasure, and beauty, and I can't see any ugly people. Even the polar bear's cute. These are women from the 1920s, and as you can see, they're all rosy-cheeked and cute, and they're all drinking Coke. This is a girl from the 1940s, Coca-Cola girl. This is a girl from the 1930s, and here's an advertisement. Handsome young man going fishing. What could be more pleasurable than that? Look at the clouds in the background. He's got two Cokes. He's going to put them in the water to cool off. And here is his dog. And then, of course, there's the polar bears on an ice floe. Coca-Cola makes you want to drink Coca-Cola, doesn't it? And these are cigarette commercials from the past. This is the 1940s, 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 1980s, I think. And there's Joe Camel. He's cool. Rides a motorcycle. Got a leather jacket on. Turkish Jade Camel cigarettes, menthol. Lady in a slinky dress. And, of course, she says that this is a champion bronc rider, and she just loves him because he smokes Camel cigarettes. He's a handsome young man, and she's a lovely young lady, and she's a spar. Spars were Coast Guard, I think. And here's beer commercials. There's your deer. Light beer. Here's all these pretty people playing or bowling. Here's Miller Lite. He's hitting the ball. And of course, there's a car. And it's time to satisfy your beer tooth. Miller time. Now, why she has a bottle cap in her mouth, you can. But it has to do with this word right here, satisfy. And she's got a this is fairly sensual, so anyway, if you want to know what it means, I'll tell you, if you can't figure it out. The ultimate goal of advertisers, preachers, and even college professors is to have people pay attention to their message. This usually involves some form of behavior change. Change is most likely to occur when people think deeply about a topic. Arguments are not as likely to change someone's behavior as to get the individual thinking, which in turn changes their behavior. Thus, the simple route is the most likely to change someone's behavior. They need to think about it, and you need to make them think. Now, that's the hardest part, is making somebody think about something. A lot of things just come through. You don't even put them in your brain. It just goes in one ear and goes out the other. You cram for exams. You don't even think about it. And that's one of the reasons I have you writing the discussions that you are. And the reason is because I'm trying to get you to think. It's a trick.
That's a trick.
Life has become so complex that many times people do not think about decisions that must be made, but believe experts are trusted friends. This is a rule of thumb heuristic that many people live by. For backers of George W. Bush, just being told that the invasion of Iraq was necessary was enough to convince them of the necessity. Cynics or Democrats were more circumspect, so they didn't quite believe it. This is back in after 9/11. Primary elements of persuasion, the communicator, who's doing the communicating, what is the message? Is it a good message? Is it a strong message? How the message is communicated, how are you, is this on television? Is it on the radio? Is it an influencer? Is it on TikTok, a 15-second video? And who is the audience that we're talking to? So we have the message, we have how they do it, we have the audience, and we have the person that is making the statement. Whoops, went the wrong way. Communicator is the most effective when when he preaches or she preaches to the choir, when he is talking to people who already believe what he says. And this is one of the reasons why, if you look at a Trump rally, they don't let people in who are not Trumpians, who are not do not back Donald Trump. A lot of times they won't let in people who are look like they might not agree with him, like African Americans or Hispanics. When Trump first started his campaign to become president in 2015, he came actually came to the Quad Cities. And at the time I was teaching at Ashford, and some of my students went down to see him. Well, some of my students were black and some of my students were Hispanic, and they let in, they wouldn't let in the guy that was black, but they let in the Hispanic, but somebody followed him around the whole time, making sure he didn't cause trouble. So he was being watched to make sure that he didn't say anything negative or yell at Donald Trump. They were ready to kick him out. Was really kind of weird. They let in all the white people, but the black guy they wouldn't let in, and there were three Hispanic guys, and two of them they wouldn't let in, and one of the guys actually got in. It was just fascinating because he said they followed him the whole time. Somebody went with him the whole time. Wherever he went. They followed him around and kept an eye on him. For a speaker to influence someone, they must have credibility, believability, most likely with someone considered an expert and trustworthy. When someone delivers a message that we don't consider credible, sometimes we will forget the speaker but remember the message. And this is known as the sleeper effect. So we remember the message and we think, wait a minute, I've heard something about that. I can't remember who said it, but this is what they said. Low credibility may be caused by a discounting cue, such as when a prediction of improving economic conditions is given by a government spokesperson who is presumed to be biased. However, when the message eventually gets separated from its source by dissociation, the message may gain more credibility. So, and this was one of Trump's tricks. Trump's figured that when he first said something, that people were going to say, "Oh, that's not right, that's not right." But eventually, if he said it enough times, people would start believing it, because if you hear it enough times, then maybe you'll believe it. There was a poem that was written a number of years ago at the turn of the 20th century. By Lewis Carroll, the guy that wrote Alice in Wonderland. And he said, "What I tell you three times is true." In other words, you're not going to believe it the first time I tell you. You're not going to believe it the second time I tell you. But by the third time, you've heard it so many times that you're going to believe it. And that is a trick that Donald Trump has endorsed in the Art of the Game, The Art of the Deal. That's the book he wrote, and that's what he said. That's, you know, he uses hyperbole, and he repeats things over and over, and eventually, with the people that aren't thinking, they forget to not believe it. Yeah. Okay, so why did I put this picture in here? This has to do with the war in Iraq. Of course, the reason that President Bush said that he was going into Iraq was to get rid of the weapons of mass destruction, and strangely enough, they didn't find any weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. People can be afforded expert status either through their perceived knowledge. Doctors are assumed to have medical knowledge. PhDs in psychology would be more likely to have expertise in suicide prevention. Individuals who deliver information in a straightforward manner rather than in a hesitant manner are considered more believable. When people look their audience in the eye, they are perceived by the audience as more believable. Trustworthiness is also higher if the audience believes the communicator isn't trying to persuade them. We also perceive as sincere individuals who argue against their own self-interest. When the environmentalist known as Green Gene spoke at the rally to save the California coastline from offshore oil drilling, she really didn't persuade anyone not already convinced to change their minds. But when Harvey Selby, a former vice president of Arco Oil, spoke out against the drilling because of the oil companies' callous feelings about the environment and drive for profits, he was much more persuasive. Why? Because she seemed to have an ulterior motive, but he didn't, since he was an Arco Oil vice president. Of course, Arco Oil is all over California, and they do most of the drilling in that area. Other persuasive speaking methods, attribution, to what do we attribute the speaker's position? People who listen to Harvey Selby and see him trying to pay back Arco Oil for firing him are less likely to be swayed than people who know that he was fired by Arco Oil for speaking out against offshore drilling in California. Other persuasive speaking methods, speaking fast. People who speak fast were seen as more trustworthy than people who spoke slowly. While fast speech does not carry the same weight in Korea, researchers have found that even when speaking rates are doubled from normal speech rates, 140 to 150 words per minute, speakers are still seen as more trustworthy. Fast speech conveys power and competence. Fast speech is a good advertising ploy because it doesn't leave time to counter-argue. It most often works because it enhances peripheral route processing. Attractiveness. Attractive spokespersons are far more persuasive than unattractive spokespersons. Attractive preachers are always more successful than unattractive preachers, no matter how they deliver their sermons. This may be due to the simple fact that physical appeal is tied to acceptance at a basic level. Similarity is another reason. People are more responsive to someone in their own group. And here are a group of preachers. This is Jerry Falwell. That's Oral Roberts. That's Jimmy Swaggart. And that is, oh, come on. I can't. That's Amy Simple McPherson. She was kind of an interesting person. She came down from Canada, started her ministry. Billy Graham, that's who that is. She started her ministry in California. She had this huge radio ministry, and then all of a sudden she disappeared. She disappeared one day, and a couple of weeks later she came wandering out of... she dressed in tight outfits, and this is really kind of interesting because the 30s weren't known for their tight outfits, and she was fairly, had an ample bosom there, and she liked to lift her arms and show off her chest a lot. She was really kind of an interesting person. Anyway, she came out, she was captured. This was down on the Mexican border, and she came wandering out of the brush one day after 2 weeks, after she'd been missing for 2 weeks. And she was only dressed in her underwear. And, of course, you know, everybody just went crazy because Amy Simple McPherson was wandering around almost naked. And, of course, her beauty was one of the reasons that people were so enamored with her message. Really kind of fabulous stuff. And, of course, the rest of these guys are all evangelical preachers. There's another attractive preacher. And that's Austin. I can't think of his first name. Not the ugliest guy in the world. And that's Van Impe and his wife, Roxella. My brother likes to watch these guys because he doesn't believe any of it, but he likes to listen to it and laugh at some of the stupid things that they say or some of the predictions that they make. It's really kind of interesting. They're on late at night. Van Impe, I can't think of his first name, but his wife's name is Roxella. And she sits right beside him, and no matter what he says, she always agrees with him. It's all scripted. It's a lot of fun. And my brother just laughs a lot when he sees that. And this is Jim Baker and his wife. I can't think of her name. Anyway, he's still alive and he's still got a ministry. They defrauded. They used to make money hand over fist. I used to watch these guys on television. I thought it was really kind of fun. She wore a lot of mascara and she cried a lot. And when she cried, of course, her mascara ran down her face. And this was part of what this is part of their shtick. Anyway, television preachers. Who says something is important, but of course, of equal importance is what the person is saying. Reasons versus emotion. Orators for ages have Tammy Faye Baker. That's what her name was. This is Tammy Faye, and that's Jim Baker. The interesting thing about his name was it had two K's in it to set him apart from all other Bakers, I guess. I taught high school in Nebraska, and the guy that was the head of the school board, his name was Kent Smith. Kent Smith was his last name. And when he went to, he was a psychiatrist, and when he went to school, his name was Smith. And then he decided to put his middle name and his last name together to set him apart from all the other Smiths. So that's what he did. And Jim Baker, of course, was not born with two K's in his last name. He just changed it so that he would stand apart from all the other Bakers in the world. Okay, what are we talking about? Orators for ages have debated which is the most persuasive reason or emotion. Researchers have discovered that it really all depends on the audience as to which approach is the most successful. The better educated the audience, the more likely that reason will carry more weight than emotion. And of course, if you've ever listened to a Trump rally, not a whole lot of reason taking place, trying to get them all stirred up, trying to stir up their emotions. And of course, his audience isn't the best educated audience in the world either. These audiences are more used to arriving at decisions through the central route, the educated audience, as compared to the peripheral route. So if he's actually dealing with an educated audience, getting them all stirred up is not going to work because they want to reason, they want to understand why things are happening. Researchers looking at major elections have discovered that when decisions about the candidates are established by reason, emotional appeals do not work. On the other hand, when decisions about candidates are based on emotion, reason has very little impact on changing the individual's mind about the candidate. And this is one of the reasons why the January 6th committee, despite the fact that they're finding all this evidence that Trump tried to overthrow the government, tried to become the president despite the fact he lost the election by 7 million 7 million votes, and despite the fact that he lost the Electoral College by, I don't know, what it's 50 or 60 points, most people, it won't make an impact on how people feel about him, because the people that like him because of, for emotional reasons, not for logical reasons. And the people that don't like him for emotional reasons too. But they're, now they have the reasons. But of course, the question is, are the independents watching all this? It's usually Republicans are fairly staunch, and so are Democrats, so are liberals. But the people that decide the elections are usually the independents that don't claim either Democratic or Republican connections. And this is a joke about Nazis, also about his little bitty hands. And here's, I got his little hands as well. I condemn Nazis when they're late for work. And Gorka was fairly fascistic. So was Steve Bannon. And this is Miller. I can't remember his first name. I'm sick and tired of my opponents twisting my words. Hillary's sick and tired. Tick, tick, tick. I think she's trying to delete us, investigate Hillary's emails, Inspector Generals. Okay. The slogans seem a little weird this time around. Clinton, extremely careless and ready to lead. Trump, there's no substitute for inexperience. Hillary, unindicted as of today. Trump threw caution to the wind. I'm with her-ish. What he doesn't know won't hurt you, Trump. And, of course, that's a joke. Hillary's past chasing her, Benghazi, Vince Foster, Cattle Futures, Travelgate, Watergate, Warhawk, presidential. Anyway, Hackwee's cop, maybe she'll cough up some of those missing emails. Messages, and that's a 2016 election. I didn't have any from the 2020 election. Messages and good feelings. Researchers have found that when subjects have good feelings, they are more likely to be persuaded. Researchers at Yale University discovered that they were more likely to convince individuals. Joel Osteen, his first name's Joel. I couldn't think of his first name just a minute ago. Researchers at Yale University discovered that they were more likely to convince individuals on select topics if the individuals were given snacks when the topics were presented. I don't know if this makes any sense to you, but if people are feeling good and you give them a little bit of food, everybody's happy. And so they are more likely to accept what you say. Thus, when good feelings are coupled with a message, the good feelings are more likely to be acquainted with the message. Messages and fear. Messages can also be effective by evoking negative emotions. Governments have been trying for years to persuade people to stop smoking, taking drugs, and buckle up when driving. If too much fear is used, the people miss the message because they tune out the painful message. Researchers have found that fear does not work to change pleasurable habits, such as using sunscreen, using condoms, and eating healthy foods. The people just go into denial. And there is an advertisement for tobacco. There's an advertisement for tobacco. You're choking your child to death. Major cause of stroke, very addictive, raises blood pressure, suppresses immune function, dulls senses of smell and taste, reduces stamina, wrinkles your skin, leads to depression and fatigue, may cause fatal heart attacks, and may cause emphysema. It's like they're bullets. $15 for sex isn't normal, but on meth it is. This has to do with the Montana meth project. They were trying to, a billionaire who lived in Montana, his son died of a meth overdose. And he was trying to, he decided to put all this money into these advertisements. And of course, she's a prostitute and she's having sex for $15 so that she can buy her meth. And this is one of the advertisements from the Montana Meth Project. And there's another one. Before meth, I had a daughter. Now I have a prostitute. And this is one about car crashes. Without a seatbelt, a crash can be deadly even at 20 kilometers per hour. This is from Europe, of course. Discrepancy when the message is very different from the message that people want to hear. Only a credible source can change people's behavior. A non-credible source is less likely to persuade an audience, even if they don't disagree as strongly. One-sided versus two-sided appeals. A one-sided appeal works best with people who agree. A two-sided appeal works best with those who don't agree, so that you show both sides. If the people already agree, then all you need to do is show the positive, the one side. And that's one of the reasons why Trump's rallies were so negative. And the reason is because he didn't need to argue both sides of the argument. He only needed to argue his side because everybody in the audience were on his side. Of course, when I watch these things, I don't agree with him now. Of course, I'm listening to what he's saying and I'm thinking, why isn't anybody in the audience calling him a liar? And it's because, well, those people have been hustled out before the whole thing starts. Primacy versus recency. Primacy effect, when all things are equal, the information presented first usually has the most influence. At times, the information presented last has more of an influence when what was presented first, the recency effect, and this is known as a recency effect. Enough time separates the two messages, the audience commits itself soon after the first message. Active experience versus passive reception. When people actively receive a message, taking notes, highlighting, responding, they're more likely to remember the message than when they passively receive information. Passive reception, such as advertising, is not as powerful, but is received all the same. Readily accepted material, where a sexual, attractive, funny, or frightening theme is used, is very difficult to filter out. And they're trying to get people to stop torturing elephants. This is from Thailand. And of course, they use a very attractive young lady who's naked and hobbled, just like an elephant. Active experience versus passive reception. When people actively receive a message. Wait a minute, have I gone the wrong direction? Yes, I have. Oh, there's another one, okay. Before Zhang Ji kicks your butt, she drinks a refreshing glass of milk. There you go. And these are two of the top Bollywood stars. That's Arai is her last name. My friend's going to kill me because he's in love with her. Anyway, they're selling coke and they're the two most popular Bollywood actors. Aishwarya Rai, that's what her name is, Aishwarya Rai. She was Miss Universe or Miss World or something back in the 1990s. She is very attractive. There's the Marlboro man who died of lung cancer. This is a really weird advertisement. These two people in the bathtub, and she's got a surprised look on her face. We don't have a caption for it. This is from Denmark. What she's so surprised about is that she has just discovered this banking organization, and they are such a good organization. That's why she's so shocked. Doesn't have anything to do with anything else, according to the advertisement. And this is the famous horse fart advertisement from Budweiser. And of course, this is the early Viagra. Viagra, of course, has gone generic now. So the whole blue football thing. Anyway, and this has to do with cholesterol testing. This person is obviously dead. That's a toe tag. And of course, they're not, because you can see that the skin's still nice and pink. Anyway, personal versus media influence. People tend to be more powerful, be a more powerful influence than media is. So if you can get people to talk to other individuals, they're more likely to convince them. In a famous study from 1954 by Samuel Eldersveld and Richard Dodge, three groups of, this is Samuel Eldersveld, by the way, three groups of people were created over a select political issue. The first group were just allowed media coverage, and about 19% changed their minds and voted for the proposal. The second group were influenced through mailings. About 45% changed their minds and voted for the proposal. The last group were given a personal face-to-face appeal. 75% changed their minds and voted for the proposal. So if you go door-to-door and you talk to people, you're going to change more minds than if you use mailers or you just use media. Two-step flow of communication. In most instances, the media's influence occurs through opinion leaders represented on the media, which in turn influence others. This is known as the two-step flow of communication. Thus, media influence often occurs despite the fact that a select individual may not have access to it. Other individuals with access to the media will influence the individual with information from the media. Order persuasiveness. Live presentations, of course, work best. Videotape presentations work second best. Audio tapes where they can't see your face work third best. And written presentations are the least likely to convince anybody. Oddly, messages are the best comprehended and recalled when written, though it is the least persuasive of all the means of presentation. The more complex the message, the more persuasive written presentations become. People with low self-esteem are often slow to comprehend a message and therefore hard to persuade. People with high self-esteem may comprehend yet remain confident in their own opinions. People with moderate self-esteem are the easiest to influence. And this is one of the reasons why Trump's revolution that occurred in 2016 occurred mostly in the middle class. They weren't people with low, they weren't the poor people, they weren't the highly educated people. It was the people in between that were the ones that were the most easily, or they became his adherents, the ones with moderate self-esteem. Life cycle explanation, attitudes change, become more conservative as people age. Generational explanation, attitudes developed in youth persist unchanged. They tend to be different from attitudes developed by people with less or different experiences, and therefore a generation gap develops. When I went back home for my high school reunion, I was shocked to find out how many of these people who were union people when I left there at age 17, they were all from families of union people or farmers, and they were all Democrats. Well, there were so many conservatives now. Why had they changed? Well, their life experience was different than mine. I became more liberal. They became more conservative. Because they worked in factories and the factories had closed. So they were blaming the unions. They were blaming everybody but themselves. The generational explanation is the most evident of the two explanations. Older people are less likely to change than young people are. Research shows that as people age, they do change their attitudes. Their attitudes tend to evolve with changing times. Though they may be worse, more set due to experience than the more easily changed young person. The young are more readily influenced by what the older person sees as fads. On the other hand, events that occur in a person's youth and teen years tend to be the most influential to their lives. Thoughtfulness, if the message provokes favorable thoughts, it persuades us. If the message provokes us to think of contrary arguments, we remain unpersuaded. If we know that someone is going to try to persuade us, we're more likely to counter-argue. When an issue is considered trivial, argument or even propaganda can be successful. Distraction disarms counter-arguing. If an individual can be distracted, they often will be too distracted to counter-argue. uninvolved audiences use peripheral cues. Trivial matters or uninvolved audiences tend to utilize peripheral cues rather than cognitive cues. And this is one of the reasons why people will bring up really strange things and start to make counter arguments that really don't make a lot of sense. They try to trivialize the issue, even though this issue is important, like the January 6th committee. If you're listening to Republicans, they're saying, well, that's not important. This is not important as compared to what's happening right now. The gas prices should be what we care about, not the fact that Donald Trump almost overthrew democracy with the January 6th insurrection. We can get people to think about issues by asking rhetorical questions, make people feel responsible for the issue, or repeating the message. And of course, that is the trick that is used by Donald Trump. He repeats the message so many times, he hopes people are forgetting why it even came up. He just wants them to believe what he says. A cult is a new religious movement characterized by distinctive ritual and beliefs related to its devotion to a god or a person, isolation from the surrounding evil culture, headed by charismatic leaders. These are, for examples, Jim Jones, David Koresh, Sun Myung Moon, and Marshall Applewhite. I'm going to explain all of these. And this is the movie called, Where's My Car, I think. And this is Zoltan from that movie. If it comes up, there we go. Rockin' to
the beat. It is now my great pleasure to present to you our wise and powerful leader, Zoltan.
Zoltan!
Zoltan! We are finally going to fulfill our prophecy of outer space travel. They laughed at us when we said that aliens existed, and they mocked us when we started wearing bubble wrap jumpsuits, but who's laughing now, huh? I'll tell you who's laughing now. We are! Soon we will leave this lame planet and fly through outer space with cool aliens who like us. It is going to be awesome! Zoltan!
That's them! They knocked us out and stole our spacesuits!
No, we didn't.
Yeah, you did!
No, we didn't.
Yes, you did!
No, we didn't.
Yes, you did!
Hey, who are you gonna believe? Us or them?
Zoltan. Okay. Fun stuff. Okay. Anyway, all right. Jim Jones in the People's Temple. Jim Jones is where term drinking the Kool-Aid came from. Jim Jones started out in Indianapolis, Indiana. He's actually from a town about 20 miles east of where I'm from. He became a preacher. As you can see, he's relatively good looking. He found affected people that were poor, and he convinced them that if they gave him their money, then he would see that they made it to heaven. Eventually went out to the West Coast. He started a group out there. And he was persecuted in California, so he went to Sri Lanka. He went to Suriname. Suriname, and he took all these people with him. The whole time he's bilking them out of all this money. He built himself a camp. People went out there to try to figure out what was going on because these were American citizens. He killed a member of the House of Representatives who tried to figure out what was going on. At that point, he realized that the jig was up, and he had the people drink the drink the poison so that they committed suicide. And, of course, he drank the Kool-Aid as well. And all these people died, not just adults, but also children. Jim Jones and the People's Temple. David Koresh, he was head of a group called the Branch Davidians. This is in Waco, Texas. He built himself a compound. Sex was involved with it as well. He was a very charismatic leader. He started breaking laws. The laws he started breaking had to do with guns. And the ATF came in, arms, tobacco, and fire. That's not alcohol, tobacco, and firearms. ATF came in. There was a gun battle that took place. At some point, he was running the place on bottled gas, and one of the tanks blew up, and it blew up the whole place. Everybody died. Everybody inside died. The FBI attacked, of course, and David Koresh perished along with all of the people that were in his group, including a lot of kids. And one of the questions was he abusing the children? There were stories that he was having sex with the younger girls, 14 and 15-year-old girls. And he had to have sex with them before anybody else married them. Anyway, everybody died. Sung Myung-moon and the Unification Church, this came out of Korea. He believed that there was somebody for everyone. And all they needed to do was select them. And he was able to select what two people should get married, and his wife had the same capability. But they would have these mass weddings where people would come filing in, and he would say, no, you need to be married to this person. And they did. They got married. This happened. He moved out to California from Korea. And it wasn't just Koreans. They were part of the church. Eventually he died. And of course, people considered this a Christian cult of sorts. The church still exists, and they still have these mass weddings. And Marshall Applewhite, we've talked about Marshall before, I think we have. Maybe that was in another class. Anyway, Marshall Applewhite started this group in the 1970s called Heaven's Gate. The idea was that if they did everything the way they were supposed to do it, if they were pure, if they pledged themselves to this lifestyle, that they would, the aliens would come and pick them up in a spaceship. And the alien spaceship would be behind a comet. And in 1993, the Hale-Bopp comet streaked across the sky. The reason we hadn't ever seen this comet before, nobody knew it was there. And all of a sudden, these two guys, one from Thailand and one from the United States, a guy by the name of Hale and a guy with the last name of Bopp, discover this thing, and they call it the Hale-Bopp Comet. And, of course, in the summer of 1993, you could see it streaking across the sky. It was there all summer. I remember it from 1993. Theoretically, there was an alien spaceship behind the meteor, and the Heaven's Gate people decided that they were going to get aboard, so they committed suicide to get aboard. And there are still some people that didn't commit suicide, and you can actually see them on the internet from time to time. Marshall Applewhite. Attitudes follow behavior. New initiates, we're talking about cult indoctrination. New initiates into a cult are made to live a rigid ritualistic existence that not only controls their behavior, but through their activities makes them an important full-fledged member of the cult community. This strengthens the individual's membership in the cult, and they become more likely to change their attitude. The greater the personal commitment, the more the need to justify it. Attitude, of course, follows behavior. And this is a technique that the military uses as well. This is what basic training is all about. They're not really trying to create a cult. we can pretend. But what they're trying to do is make you obedient to what's happening in the military structure. So it's kind of the same thing, if you think about it. But then again, anytime you join any organization, sometimes you get this same type of treatment. Different churches will do the same thing. But of course, they're not considered cults. Often an astute cult leader will use the foot-in-the-door technique to recruit people to become part of his group. He will make only a simple request in the beginning that the individual will have a hard time denying. By gradually increasing the demands, they don't seem too oppressive, though to look at the situation from the beginning, they tend to have given up quite a bit. The communicator is usually an attractive, charismatic leader like Marshall Applewhite, Song Myung-moon, David Koresh, and Jim Jones. Pretty people. Trust is established by having much of the recruiting being done by friends or relatives. Middle-class white kids are the easiest to recruit because they tend to be more trusting. Lower-class kids have too much street smarts to go for the obvious hustle. Upper-class kids have been trained from birth to be wary of the scam. So the intelligent or the rich kids aren't fooled, and neither are the poor kids, except in the case of Jim Jones. Jim Jones, well, anyway, he was able to pull all those people in. For the lonely or the chronically rejected, the message of warmth and acceptance is very appealing. The message tends to be repeated in different forums, from one-on-one discussions to small group meetings to large lectures. Trust the master, join the family, the master has the answer. And that is, of course, what all of those people were saying. Marshall Applewhite, Song Myung-moon, David Koresh, and Jim Jones. Trust the master, join the family, the master has the answer. Recruits are often young, under the age of 25, before their attitudes and values stabilize. Of course, 25 is when your brain finally matures, and that's when you gain your adult brain at age 25. They may be less educated and unable to counter-argue the simple message. Most turn out to be educated, middle-aged individuals at a turning point in their lives, facing a personal crisis, living away from home, looking for an escape. Times of social upheaval create possible converts. Cult typically separates members from their previous social support systems and isolates them with their cultists. Scientology is considered a cult. This creates a phenomenon known as social implosion, where the members only socialize with other members. They're cut off from family and friends, and so are also cut off from counter-arguments. The group defines reality and offers identity. The cult may punish wrong thinking and supports consensus. One problem with arguing against a point of view is that if the argument isn't strong enough, it merely polarizes people against the argument. The individual builds resistance to further arguments. This is referred to as attitude inoculation. The individual is prepared for stronger attacks because weak arguments prepare them to counter-argue. And that is the end of that. If you want to know about cults, look up Scientology. There has been a lot of people talking about Scientology lately. The Scientologists, well, Scientology is really kind of interesting. Maybe I needed to make it part of this lecture as well. But I'll see you guys next week.